For example, the DRC, Mali, South Africa, Ghana, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Burkina Faso have got very attractive geology. Then companies may risk to enter the exploration market even if the countries are not politically stable. Okay. However, the regulatory framework and policies governing mineral exploration and mining will be the most important factor. For example, Zimbabwe, despite having a very good and attractive geology, exploration companies have dwindled to a very, very, very low level. This is because Zimbabwe put in a policy that means that the company must own 50% and the local must own 50%. And this local participation is required of companies that come into the country, regardless of how much money the locals put in. Okay, and that policy has made investors to run away. It's an example of exploration spending, the amount of money that has been spent by companies. Gold exploration, base metals, diamonds, platinum group metals, and other metals. So the gray part is 2010 and 2009. You can see that there's been a lot of investment in gold and not so much in base metals and not so much in diamonds. Policy, national law, and international laws. Mining is an international business, and national laws must also accord with international laws. Therefore, the policies must cover these broad areas. Okay, public international law, domestic law, and transnational law. These laws must be known and taken into account when crafting policies on mining. The most important thing is that the policy that is crafted takes care of the international legislation, the local legislation, and indeed, legislation involving companies operating in that particular country. Public international law is largely about how nations relate to each other, for example, in treaties, and has little content about mining, which is considered a matter to be regulated by each nation in relation to mining within their country. Two exceptions are there. For example, Chile and Argentina. So between the border of these two countries, Chile and Argentina, okay, a mine is subject to a treaty between these two countries. And mining in international areas, for example, treaties addressing mining on the seabed and Antarctic. Okay, they are, however, increasing international standards on subjects relevant to mining operations and regulations. Examples include the human rights and environmental protection, investment protection, anti-corruption measures, business regulation, for example, harmonization of business law in Africa. Let's look at domestic law. Domestic law is a law made by a nation to regulate activities in its country by its nationals. Typical sources of law relevant to mining will be the country's constitution, parliamentary laws, and subsidiary laws. In various African countries, there is still a formal role for traditional authorities in management of land and resources. For example, in Ghana, Sierra Leone, and Botswana, traditional authorities still have a say in the mining of resources. Domestic law has a mining or mineral code outlining the basic rights and responsibilities and exploration of mining. However, countries will also have many laws about other subjects, which also may control aspects or parts of it. Examples of domestic laws. Okay, let's look at some of these. Good examples are business regulation, workplace safety, land management, transport, use of dangerous products, planning and development, taxation, environmental protection, employment, foreign investment, and heritage protection. The mining can be categorized according to home country or host country. The terms host and home apply where the mining is undertaken in one country, which is the host country, by a company which is from another country, which is the home country. These two domestic laws will likely regulate different. So, for example, Canada has laws that affects their mining companies which are operating outside Canada. And these are standards which operate beyond the state, but are not international law. between nations. These have growing significance in mining regulation. As we are talking of Canada, Canada imposes, requires its companies operating abroad to conduct mining in a certain way. Okay, there are many examples, including the following. Controls imposed through lenders, World Bank, operation guidelines on projects, the Equator principles, as for example, extractive industry transparency initiative. Okay, how the money from the mining industry is to be used. Okay, standards about reporting of mineral deposits. This is very technical. For example, the JORC is the Australian standard of how to report mineral deposit. In other words, it tells us how much minerals are still in the ground. And SAMREC is the South African standard of reporting mineral deposit. And the UN also has its own standards for international companies. For example, in the OECD, Western Europe, they have guidelines for multinational enterprises. National Atomic Energy Agency, it has got safety standards that it imposes when dealing with the uranium, for example. The role of parliaments in natural resource management. Parliaments have a role beyond just making the law, but also in overseeing the executive. In the management of natural resources, legislators, they bear the responsibility of ensuring that policy and regulatory frameworks support their sustainable use and exploitation, and that government agencies appropriately allocate and account for revenues. Unfortunately, most of the African countries, unlike the US model, they lack checks and balances in this regard. Okay? So parliaments should have this power so that the power can be used to ensure that the mining of mineral resources is fair. Okay? Inherited colonial legal instruments. So most African countries, even though they are independent, they still have on their books laws and legal instruments that were inherited from the colonial days. Okay, now these inherited legal frameworks, they are sometimes not very good for the local, for the locals. Okay, that is because the colonial governments favored a regime that allowed outside companies to extract and export resources to their home countries. France, United Kingdom, Portugal, Italy, Germany, all used the colonies as a source of raw materials. After independence, very little changed in the legal framework, as most of the people who were educated in these countries actually were educated in their former colonies. Okay, so when they came back, they still maintained those laws. Okay, policy basics. So the conceptual framework of most mineral analysis and policy is that mining, okay, now, let's understand it that a company is going to mine, all right, and make a profit. Now, this should not be assumed nor accepted in every case, but it is a very dominant paradigm, and so it's important to understand that. The only government role which such analysis will countenance is government being an independent regulator to referee a competing businesses and to balance or ameliorate the mining impacts on some people with mining benefits to more people. However, governments must be allowed to have various models. Canada, for example, gets involved in mining through its state-owned companies, and Chile as well, okay? Chile has got a company known as Codeco, and Canada has got a company known as SOCIM. These are mining companies that are successful, but they are owned by the government. Key questions for formulating local content policies. This is derived from the UN 2018 paper. Supply of local goods and services. Are they limited to goods and services produced using local or input labor? Other parties to mine minerals. Okay, this only is only found in Sierra Leone and South Africa. Although it's being slowly changed in South Africa, to follow with the Dutch law. Common mineral rights for titles. This allows the permit holder to access the area for mineral exploration, even if it's an agricultural area,
bro.
Or it has got a different other function, it still be accessed. Okay. So, or mining title. This allows the person to actually mine. All right, which is 25 to 40 years, which can be right. So titles are usually granted separately as permits by the relevant government agency. Policies on foreign investment controls. Okay, there need to be policies on direct investment by another government, policies on investment by private industry over a certain monetary amount, policies on investment in resources considered strategically important, for example, such as nuclear minerals in areas considered to be sensitive because of their proximity to national border or military establishments. So there need to be policies on foreign investment procedures. Okay, now this is important because foreign investment procedures are usually undertaken separately from acquiring mineral rights. So the policies must try to unite this so that it becomes a uniform policy. Okay, methods by which government allocate mineral rights. Government can allocate mineral rights basically by three basic methods. Okay, the first one is a competitive process by tender or auction. This is very common in the gas and oil. So the government is going to call for people to buy blocks of land where they are going to do the exploration. The other one is called a free entry process, where most parties can obtain the right on compliance with basic conditions. And the last one is the negotiated agreement. The country's mining law will specify the method of allocating mineral rights, which must be used, or allow the government to use different methods in different circumstances. Mineral rights and land access. So policies on mineral rights need to be crafted in such a way that conflict and litigation can be avoided. Okay? Policy must take into account the following: the security of tenure. When somebody has obtained a license, what is their security of tenure? Okay? Regulations or conditions which need to be fulfilled in order to renew the license. So this must be clear in the policy that when a company has done A, B, C, D, then their license can be renewed. If a company has not done one of these, then their license cannot be renewed. The exact amount of work that requires to be as a minimum in order for the government to renew the exploration license. The expected obligations to the state and landowners must also explain the issues of water rights on the land and how the exploration mining company will access it. Okay. In jurisdictions where national participation condition is required, fair explanation must be provided that gives the rights of both investors, the local and the foreign. Okay. So these rights, they must be vested. They must be vested in the holder. The policy and license has to be specific on how the granting or confirming of ownership is going to be done of public and private land. Okay? Public land is the land which is owned by the government, and private land is the land which is owned by people, ordinary people. They own the land separately. So the policy must state exactly how to acquire exploration or mining rights on public land and how to acquire exploration or mining rights on private land. Providing free transfer of publicly owned surface rights to the mine rights holder. Giving the mining title holder an automatic right to access the relevant land. Enforcing on private landholders access and use of rights for the miner. Mining in effect being given preferential use of the land. Okay. What the policy has to show and specify also should include, okay, the surface holder agreement before the mining, but providing arbitration. Compensation where agreement cannot be reached. For example, in Uganda, when there's no agreement between mining company and the landholder, compensation. Okay, it should also specify access against the landowner's wishes, where that is in the national interest. For example, it's private land and the private owner does not want the mining company to come onto the land. So the policy must state exactly what the owner of the license should do to access the land, giving the surface holder a complete veto over mining. Okay, that is also should be stated whether is that whether the complete veto is there or not. Okay, for example, in Namibia, the mining has a preference over any other activity on the land. So, the effect of policies and unresolved issues. Analysis has summarized four central concerns about poverty and mining: ownership and control of territories by local communities, self-determination through informed consent, participation, and engagement, the right of the local groups to represent themselves through their own institutions, food security. Clearly, the fulfillment of these cannot occur through the mining law alone. And this is where community development agreements must be reached. These community development agreements, they ensure that the locals who own the land and the mine, they agree on developmental projects. Recommendations for mineral tax regulations be clearly written and understood by both government and industry. It should be transparent, equitable, predictable, and stable. It should achieve and define government revenue collection and stability objectives without excessively compromising economic efficiency, equity, and ease of administration. These policies must be enforceable. There's no point writing a policy which you cannot enforce. And they must be supported by adequately skilled and resourced government administrative institutions and systems with good interministerial and interdepartmental coordination and information sharing. It happens that the Ministries of Mines and the Ministry of Environment, Ministries of Water normally may have conflict because the policies are not very clear. So if the policies are clear, each ministry knows what its mandate is. Policies and regulations must anticipate and minimize or preempt the need for future amendments. Where these are necessary, they should be based on the principle of no surprises. And the principle of continuous and meaningful industry consultation, avoiding perceptions of sovereign risk. Taxes that are unit-based and ad valorem royalties make use of actual volumes and realized value as shown in sales invoices, rather than contained in metal deemed prices. If incorporating more sophisticated, complex, and more economically efficient profit or rent-based taxation regimes, these policies must ensure that they are based on unequivocal methodologies and definitions for determinations of appropriate taxation base, thus reducing compliance costs, ambiguity, and the potential for litigation. This is our last slide now. Our recommendations also continue. We need to differentiate royalty taxation rates for different minerals according to their general ability to pay. For example, in most countries, the royalty is a fixed tax for all the minerals, but the royalties must be according to the different minerals. Lower royalty taxation rates negotiated at the individual project level should not be viewed as an effective means of providing investment incentives and subsidies. Okay, these policies must have penalties for non-compliance that are proportionate and progressive, increasing from penalty interest to fines to forfeiture of mining titles. And they should involve appropriate but not excessive ministerial powers of discretion and determination that, if excessive, may become the source of inequitable decisions and they may be open to abuse. All right, thank you. That's the end.